We're no longer in the realm of science fiction. The International Society for Cell and Gene Therapy and several other scientific organizations are calling for a 10-year ban in human genetic editing. Dr. Bruce Levine, a professor for cancer gene therapy at the University of Pennsylvania, writes, "Germline editing has very serious safety concerns that could have irreversible consequences. We simply lack the tools to make it safe now and for at least the next 10 years. This comes as new software from a company called Nucleus Genomics is giving IVF patients the ability to screen and rank embryos with unprecedented precision. How? They break down the full genetic profile of each embryo in a dashboard just like this that can show up to 900 diseases from cancer and Alzheimer's to schizophrenia and asthma, alongside non-medical traits like height, eye color, even markers related to IQ. Parents can upload up to 20 embryo DNA files and sort by whatever attributes they care about most. The company calls it genetic optimization. Its CEO, Kayan Sadehi, is a 25-year-old who raised millions from tech investors like Peter Thiel and Alexis Ohanian. Sadehi told the Wall Street Journal that his company, quote, is about living a longer, healthier life. But the broader implications are these. It's not just about avoiding Tay-Sachs or cystic fibrosis. It's about deciding who gets to be born. Newsweek reports that users are already comparing embryos by projected IQ, BMI, and likelihood of mental illness. Critics say this crosses into modern eugenics. You're not just editing genes, but discarding the embryos that don't meet certain standards. And as Reason's Liz Wolf writes, this isn't about baby Mozart anymore. It's about a world where parental choice intersects with Silicon Valley hubris and deeply personal ethics. All this taking place in an area that's largely unregulated. There are no federal laws that prohibit polygenic embryo screening. And while many in the longevity movement, including Sadehi, described this as empowering, ethicists warn it could lead to a society that values perfection over personhood. Joining us now is someone who's been thinking about these issues for literally decades, Dr. Arthur Caplan, head of the Division of Medical Ethics at NYU School of Medicine. Dr. Caplan, great to see you. You've been teaching about this potential for literally 40 years.
Well, you could look forward, Michael, ever since the mapping of the human genome, where we had scientists figure out all of the genes' locations that are on our genes, which are in every cell. That took place 23 years ago. And once that map was made, then you start to look for associations between those little genes and our traits and behaviors and attributes. And so it doesn't take, imputing myself, but it doesn't take a big genius to figure out that people are going to be interested, some, in saying, hey, let's use this knowledge we have about the role our genes play and who we are to improve ourselves.
If it's cancer, if it's heart disease, you know, I'm sure we all cheer it on. It gets creepy when it's hair or eye color or some of these other characteristics. Where is that line? Where should that line be? And how do we get there?
Well, I want to mention one trait that is in this Nucleus website. They talk about being able to get rid of insomnia. And I just did a little check. People who have suffered from and announced their insomnia range from George Clooney to Madonna to Ernest Hemingway to Marcel Proust. And indeed, your friend and mine, Dr. Franklin, Ben Franklin, was a notorious insomniac. So all of a sudden, you've got a lot of dispute about, well, what are the traits that we want to say are the best? What are the traits that really will contribute to a happy life? What are the traits that are going to allow us to make progress in the future? And I'm going to say we don't have consensus about that. And I'm even going to go further. While genes play a role in all this, they're not determinative. You know, Michael, if you look at a family, same parents, same gene sets, same environment, same upbringing, the kids don't all turn out the same. Clearly, environment and, if you will, development in the womb, they play a key role in who we are, too. So this genetic reductionism that's around, I think, in combination with uncertainty about, let's say, what the best traits are, they really give me ethical pause.
Dr. Caplan, your son or grandson might not want to be in the NBA. Right? I mean, there's also these decisions that are being made by parents that are going to determine their offspring and apply to them for the rest of their lives that may not pan out the way they had intended?
Well, what Nucleus, the company, says is, hey, let us genetically test potential mates. We'll see what kind of kids you might create. Nucleus says, let's sort through embryos and look at their traits. And all of a sudden you're thinking, is this really fair to the offspring? Raising huge expectations. You're going to be a quarterback. You're going to be a violinist. You're going to be some sort of bioethicist, a horrific future for most. You find yourself thinking, you're not letting a kid be a kid. You're not letting the kid have what I call an open future. They get to make decisions about what they want to be, what kind of person they want to be. So things that restrict the freedom of children and grandchildren, don't let them lead the lives they want, they really seem to me way outside the ethical boundaries of what we owe our kids. Sure, we want them healthier, but I don't think we want to necessarily just put them on a narrow track. Let me add one other thing, Michael. I know you're very concerned about unity in this country and social mingling. A lot of the impulse behind this effort to get to genetic optimization comes from billionaires who are saying, we don't trust this country. We don't trust ourselves to get along and have a rosy future. We're going to go to Mars, select the right people to go there, and then breed the right kind of geniuses to take on the future problems of humanity. In other words, there's a whole eugenics movement here that's built on distrust of where we are today.
A word that I should have used sooner, access. There are a lot of access issues surrounding this topic. Dr. Caplan, some social media that I want you to help me respond to. Put it up on the screen. Will genetic engineering reduce human genetic diversity in some unforeseen way that will undermine human persistence, i.e., from a species rather than an individual perspective? Will genetic engineering enhance the survival of our species? Your thought on that is what?
Well, it very well could, depending on people's proclivity to choose a pretty narrow range of traits or ways we appear or how we behave. I'll tell you what the defenders say. We'll just have to have a gigantic embryo bank with all the variability stored somewhere in case we need it.
Dr. Caplan, thanks as always for being here. It's a fascinating subject.
Hey, thank you, Michael.